Well, my healthcare brothers and sisters, we finally made it to the How to Pass Your Pediatric Advanced Life Support Like a Boss series, and that is MegaCode. So patient scenario one, you and your critical care team are called to a room of a 3-month-old male infant who was admitted to the hospital yesterday with bronchiolitis. The infant has a 3-day history of nasal congestion and low-grade temperatures. The patient's mother brought him to the hospital for difficulty breathing and not feeding adequately for the last 24 hours. Over the last 12 hours, the infant has been coughing more, his work of breathing has increased, and he has copious amounts of airway secretions. He has not been responding to the 4-hour albuterol treatments he's been receiving. So let's look at the initial impression of the patient. Appearance: irritable with mild lethargy, breathing, tachypnea, a significant work of breathing, and color is pink. So let's look at the primary assessment of the patient. The airway is patent, however, there are copious secretions noted, and the infant has significant wheezing and crackles with severe retractions. For breathing, the respiratory rate is 73, and the breathing is shallow in labor. The oxygen saturation is 86% on 4 liters nasal cannula with decreased air movement on auscultation. Circulation, the heart rate is 190, capillary refill is less than 2 seconds, and the child has only had 1 wet diaper today. IV is placed on admission, and IV maintenance fluids are infusing. Disability, the patient moves all extremities, is irritable, and mildly lethargic. Lastly, exposure, the skin is warm and the skin is pink. Your vital signs are as follows: 99.9 degrees Fahrenheit, the heart rate is 190, respiratory rate is 73, oxygen saturation is 86% on 4 liters nasal cannula, blood pressure is 95 over 52, and the chest x-ray shows no lung infiltrates and hyperinflation. So based upon the assessment findings, what is the best classification for the type of respiratory distress noted in this scenario? Is it A, upper respiratory obstruction, B, lower airway obstruction, C, lung tissue disease, or D, disordered control of breathing? That's right, the answer is lower airway obstruction. We know this because the child came in with bronchiolitis. Bronchiolitis is a disorder of lower airway. Based on the assessment, the most likely cause of the respiratory distress is lower airway obstruction. The x-ray showed hyperinflation and the child has wheezing. Both hyperinflation, wheezing, and decreased airway movement are fairly indicative of the lower airway obstruction. No infiltrates are visible on the x-ray, which decreases the likelihood of lung tissue disease such as pneumonia. Other clues include low-grade fever and a 3-day history of a runny nose. What will be the first 2 most important interventions for lower airway obstruction and respiratory distress? Is it A, give an albuterol nebulizer and provide 100% oxygen by non-rebreather mask? B, suction the nose and mouth and place an OPA, an oral pharyngeal airway? C, head tilt, chin lift, and give an albuterol treatment? Or D, suction the mouth and the nose and provide 100% oxygen by non-rebreather mask. That's right, you guessed it. We're gonna suction the mouth and nose and we're gonna provide 100% oxygenation by non-rebreather mask. The answer is D. Copious amounts of secretions present need to be cleared prior to other interventions. Since the infant has compromised oxygenation, as noted by the oxygen saturation of 86% on 4 liters nasal cannula, the next intervention is 100% oxygenation by non-rebreather mask. Albuterol treatments have failed, so this is no longer an option. An OPA would not be an option since the patient has copious secretions. The head tilt chin lift is not necessary since the patient is alert and breathing. After 5 minutes, you reevaluate the patient using the systematic approach algorithm. The primary assessment of the patient includes the airway is still patent, wheezing and crackles have improved slightly with moderate retractions. Breathing, the respiratory rate is 70 and breathing remains shallow and labored. Oxygen saturation has improved to 94%. Continued decreased air movement is noted on auscultation. circulation. The heart rate is 190. Capillary refill remains less than 2 seconds, and an IV is still intact and infusing fluids. Disability. Patient moves all extremities, remains irritable and mildly lethargic. And exposure, the skin is still warm and pink. Vital signs are as follows. Heart rate 190, respiratory rate 70, oxygen saturation 94%, and blood pressure 95 over 48. Oxygenation has improved, but the infant continues to have respiratory distress with moderate retractions, tachypnea, and decreased air movement. Based on your assessment, what two interventions should be completed next? A, racemic epinephrine nebulizer treatment. Give an IV fluid bolus of 20 milligrams per kilogram. Assist ventilation with bag mouth VAS and 100% oxygenation. Or give antibiotics. That's right, you guessed it. The answer is A and C, racemic epinephrine nebulizer treatment. And C, assist ventilation with bag mask device and 100% oxygen. By switching from a nasal cannula to non-rebreather, you may help improve oxygenation. Ventilation remains compromised significantly, so bag mask valve ventilations with 100% oxygenation are required. Racemic epinephrine may improve air movement by causing bronchial dilation. IV fluid bolus may be necessary, but this would only be after addressing the child's respiratory status first. Antibiotics aren't really indicated at this time. After another 5 minutes, we reevaluate using the systematic approach algorithm. Primary assessment of the patient, airway. The airway is still patent and there are no changes to wheezing and crackles with moderate retractions. Breathing, the respiratory rate is 50 and breathing remains shallow and labored. Oxygen saturation is 90% and you continue to note decreased air movement on auscultation. Circulation. Heart rate has increased to 200 beats per minute. Capillary refill remains less than 2 seconds, and IV is intact and infusing fluids. Disability. Patient moves all extremities, but is now a little bit weaker. Lethargy is continuing to increase. Exposure. The skin is still warm and pink. Vital signs. The heart rate is 200. Respiratory rate is 50. Oxygen saturation is 90%. And the blood pressure is now 80 over 40. Based on the assessment, what intervention should be completed next? A, give IV corticosteroids. B, continue providing bag mask ventilation. C, immediate intubation with mechanical ventilation. Or D, give 20 mLs per kilogram IV fluid bolus. That's right, y'all are getting smarter and smarter. The correct answer is C, immediate intubation with mechanical ventilation. The infant continues to have respiratory failure despite our interventions. The infant is showing decreased oxygen saturation in spite of bag mouth VAS with 100% oxygen, increased lethargy, decreasing respiratory rate, increasing heart rate, and a 10 millimeters per mercury drop in systolic blood pressure. The blood pressure drop is an ominous sign and the infant needs to be intubated immediately. All right, so our patient is sedated and intubation is confirmed using end-tidal CO2. Auscultation of low lung sounds reveal good air movements and all lung fields bilaterally. What are some laboratory studies, tests, that should be completed next? Select all that apply. A, a chest x-ray. B, arterial blood gases. C, rapid viral antigen testing of nasopharyngeal secretions for RSV, white blood cell count, D, or E, CRP, C-reactive protein. I don't know how y'all are getting so smart, but you are. The answer is everything. We want to perform all of these tests and procedures. An ABG should be obtained to evaluate respiratory and metabolic status. A chest x-ray is to confirm ET2 placement. RSV screening can cause severe bronchiolitis. White blood cell count to evaluate bacterial infections. And CRP to differentiate between viral and bacterial infections. All right, it's been another 5 minutes. We're gonna go ahead and use our systematic approach algorithm. Primary assessment of the patient. Airway, the patient's intubated. Breathing, respiratory rate is 50 on the vent and good chest rise and fall are noted. Oxygen saturation is 100% and air movement on auscultation has improved. Circulation, The heart rate is decreased to 160. Capillary refill remains less than 2 seconds. IV is intact with fluids infusing. Disability, the patient is sedated but moves slightly with stimulation. And lastly, exposure. Skin is warm and pink. So what are our vital signs? The heart rate is 160. We're on controlled mechanical ventilations of 50. The oxygen saturation is 100%. And the blood pressure has improved to 95 over 52. All right, the patient's condition is stabilizing. You begin transfer of the patient to the pediatric intensive care unit. After transfer, there is a sudden deterioration of the patient's condition. What would be expected? A, displacement of the ET tube. B, myocardial infarction. C, obstruction of the ET tube. D, shock. E, pneumothorax. Or F, equipment failure. That's right, you've guessed it again. The answer is A, C, E, and F. Using the mnemonic DOPE to remember all the possible problems if a sudden deterioration of an intubated child occurs is D, displacement of the ET tube, O, obstruction of the ET tube, P, pneumothorax, and E, equipment failure. All right, my healthcare brothers and sisters, we made it. We finally made it to the end of the series of how to pass your pediatric advanced life support like a boss. I really hope that these videos were helpful for you. I know that they were much more in-depth than the original video posted in 2017, and I had so much fun making it. If you're wanting to have more scenarios, more MegaCode scenarios, if you have additional questions regarding the pediatric advanced life support certification, or you just want to leave a comment down below, feel free to do so. I love reading them and I answer all of them. Y'all are great, and I love interacting with you. If you're not doing so already, make sure that you're following me on my social media. I'm on Facebook and Instagram, where I will reply to your messages, and I try to do it as quickly as possible. Sometimes, depending on what's going on, you know, things happen, but I try to interact with you as much as possible. But if you have anything, if you need anything, feel free to reach out to me. But until next time, I hope that y'all are having a wonderful day, and here's to another 2 years on your pediatric advanced life support certification. Bye.